John Lennon said if you were to change the name of rock and roll, you may as well make it Chuck Berry.
When Chuck Berry took the guitar and gave it life, gave it purpose. Way back up in the woods among
the evergreens. Chuck Berry, it's like all those guys, was a one-off.
The standard framework of rock and roll music, the guitar breaks, the grooves, that wouldn't exist without Chuck Berry.
Genius is reflected in his lyrics, in his music, in the way he dresses, in the dance that he invented, all of those things. This is his originality, this is his art.
When I was in first, second grade, and you know, the classic goes on, well, my dad's a fireman and cool, and well, my dad's a policeman. I said, well, my dad's the king of rock and roll. Up in the
morning and out to school. Not half he wasn't. But the poet laureate of teenage America was already 30 with a jail term behind him by the time rock and roll came a-knocking. He ended up in Chicago, where blues legend Muddy Waters took him under his wing. The door Chuck ended up banging on belonged to Chess Records.
Next day he went to my father, and when he said Muddy Waters sent me, my father brought him in. And he played two songs. When they heard the second song, Ida Red, they immediately looked at each other, my father and uncle, because we were very aware that different, unusual, unique sounds were very popular to the black community. We weren't even thinking white. You done started doing the thing
you used to do. Maybe they weren't, but what Chuck had was a plan, and a cunning one at that. The road to success was modern and fashionable, but Chuck's songs were full of farm animals and girls called Ida Red. A makeover was called for, and with an eye to the main chance, Ida Red became Maybelline, renamed for a brand of mascara.
In those days, the radios had buttons you pushed for each station, and he was compulsively pushing the buttons, listening for our records. All of a sudden, he pushed the button, and then came Maybelline by Chuck Berry. And he looked at me and he said, wow, we're on WIND, we've got it. Because they never played black music. And in fact, when Chuck Berry broke, many, many of the disc jockeys in radio stations in America didn't realize he wasn't white. And when they found out he was black, a lot of them pulled the record.
We only had like one station that blacks could be heard on from a certain time.
Blacks could not even drink water from the same water fountain that the whites did, where we couldn't walk into the front door of a restaurant to get food. They would put a rope in the city auditorium, put whites on one side and blacks on another, and they never met.
Chuck resented that he was a black man in America prevented from doing things.
Chuck wrote about things he couldn't ever be part of. He was the ultimate outsider, looking in and taking notes. The frustration he felt was transformed into songs about teenage angst, and that opened up a whole new world.
Yo, gang, you all remember Maybelline, about the young man with the guitar who couldn't catch her with his car? Well, here he is to tell us all about it with a brand new automobile, Chuck Berry, and you can't catch me.
Chuck's brilliance was understanding, you know, I can play to this black audience, but what I'm aiming for is kind of white teenage America. I bought a brand new airmobile, custom made for the flight
deal with a powerful motor and some hideaway wings. Chuck Berry was into the psyche of white teenagers. He wasn't writing for black ones. I don't know how he knew it. Maybe he had a couple teenage white girlfriends on the side. It wouldn't surprise me. At that time, it would have had to have been big secret.
He knew what he was doing. He knew that if he kept playing to everybody as opposed to any one particular group, that rock and roll as we knew it then and as it is today would be where it was.
When they started playing rock and roll, and the white folks started listening to rock and roll, that was instant integration. Because then, there were whites coming down into the black community just to hear the music.
Chuck Berry influenced everybody, certainly all the great guitarists around today.
You know, as Keith said, you know, he only has four, six chords. I said, yeah, right. And Keith would say, yeah, but The combination of those chords is the foundation of rock and roll.
Everyone's ripped off that riff, you know, many times over and over, and it's just the crazy thing about that one particular riff in Johnny B. Goode is that it's gone on for over 50 years now.
I hear the Chuck Berry double riff, but you stole that from Johnny B. Goode. I know that's almost grown. You can't fool me.
When the starts of those songs, when he's going, you know, that played on the guitar, sounds really exciting. The other thing about Chuck, I think, is that his words have a certain meter to them that you just can't, like, kind of almost the words make you want to dance.
I'm going to write a little letter, going to mail it to my local DJ. And it's a jump into the record that I want my jockey to play. See, different language.
Just hearing the words on your own, it gets you going.
Riding along in my automobile. His lyrics are so natural. You know, when he talks about No Particular Place to Go, it's about a guy and a girl going for a ride. They want to go for a walk because the moon's out. And he can't get the safety belt off. The seatbelt gets stuck, so they have to drive on. So on his way, he's all aggravated and he still can't get the safety belt loose. And it's just a fun song about what could have happened to anybody and probably did happen to thousands of young American kids.
Actually, Cliff, I think it's about sex.
Nobody had ever written about 20th century life, about cars and about jet planes whizzing over freeways night and day.
With no particular place to go.
Sweet little 16, she just got to have about a half a million.
Sharp words, sharp tunes, sharp suits.
You'd never seen anything like it. The suits, the way he performed, you know, like the old duck walk thing he did, and that guitar playing, which was really rough and raw and slightly out of tune too.
You know, first time that I can remember seeing him on stage, I was awestruck. It's like, wow, my dad is on national television. Wow, he's playing that guitar that I just saw him buy.
Knew how to get the audience up and keep them there, you know. And once he got them up and he did the duck walk, he didn't have to work anymore.
The real example of Chuck Berry is when they sent the Voyager spacecraft to outer space, they put a disc on it with Beethoven and Bach and Shakespeare, and representing rock and roll was, you know, Chuck Berry, Johnny B. Goode.
Will there be something that is cool as rock and roll? Well, personally, with what my father does, I don't think so, but I'm biased, all right?